Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Castle Dreams by John DeChancie, narrated by Kyle Burrow. Oh, tell me not in mournful numbers, life is but an empty dream, for the soul is dead that slumbers, and things are not what they seem. Life is real, life is earnest, and the grave is not its goal. Dust thou art, to dust returnest, was not spoken of the soul. Longfellow. Foreword. Yet another castle book. Again the mystery, again the enigma of Castle Perilous, presented once more in a highly colorful tale of adventure, written by John DeChancie, the purported author of all the castle romances, who, unless this investigator has completely botched the job of ferreting him out, does not exist in any known world, i.e. in any of the worlds accessible via the castle. Readers of previous books in this series will by now need no introduction to the castle, its residents, or its mysteries. However, as series books are sometimes read out of sequence, perhaps a capsule summary of the complex setting in which these stories are laid will serve as a pocket travel guide, as it were, to the world and the myriad universes of Castle Perilous. Castle Perilous is a fortress atop a citadel bestriding the plains of Baranth, situated in a region known as the Western Pale, in a world bleak and drear. Nothing definite may be said of the castle's size, save that it is vast, nor of its structure, save that it beggars description. It is no ordinary castle. Its external aspects shift and slide and rearrange, as do its labyrinthine interior spaces. It is the ultimate maze, one sometimes as terrifyingly dangerous as it is confounding. But this intermediate aspect of its nature is not the only peculiarity, for beyond almost every door and window, through almost every portal within the castle's tumultuous enclosures, lies another world. And through these portals come creatures of every description. Fanged and furred they come. Scaled and scrofulous they slither forth. Being fantastic and outré, some more horrific than the phantoms haunting the sweatiest nightmare. Not all are monsters. In point of fact, most visitors are human, and indeed, most of the non-human guests are decent enough sorts, in sharp contradistinction to their terrifying appearance. For all its bizarre nature, however, Castle Perilous is a proper castle, and even boasts a king. His name is Incarnadine, Lord of the Western Pale, and by the grace of the gods, King of the Realms Perilous. If understatement can sometimes be more eloquent than hyperbole, and more convincing, let us say that he is something of a magician, drawing on the castle itself as the source of his thaumaturgical powers. A gracious host as well, he cherishes his guests and makes them eternally welcome. What is the castle exactly, and why does it exist? That is a long story. The tales of Castle Perilous are as endless as the world it contains. Only a relative few of them have been set down. Which brings us to this present volume. This is the sixth installment of a work which bears the overarching title, The Eidolons of the King. And although past volumes have presented some problems regarding textual exegesis, this is the first book that bids fair, if its numerous puzzles continue to resist critical explication, to become that bane of scholars down through the ages, the apocryphal work. For all the castle adventures thus far have been based to some extent on truth. The tales told in preceding books were in fact true stories, so far as this castle scribe has been able to ascertain. Indeed, Some of the castle's more harrowing events are forever etched in acid on the copper plate of my memory. But this is not the case with the events related in this particular castle book. No such happenings have been recorded in Perilous's annals. No such drama ever unfolded within its dark purlieus. What, then, to make of this book? Is it simply a spurious work, written by some plagiarist with an eye toward a quick advance on royalties and sold to the hapless publisher who might know the real author? Say he is a reclusive crank, only by correspondence? I think this is unlikely. Yet I have no explanation for this volume's being different in style and content from the previous one. Conundrums abound. What are we to make of its, if you will forgive the term, postmodernist touches? For instance, the chapters labeled Spot Quiz Number Blank, and numbered accordingly. How to explain the spurious footnotes, most of which make no sense? Are these mere japes? Why is the vernacular used so extensively in the eschatological sections? Indeed, why is it that some of the questions in the quizzes have nothing to do with the text? These purported study exercises seem to be mockeries. We must conclude as much, for it is hard to credit the notion that this highly romantic bit of light entertainment was actually intended as a serious text for the study of literature. Diverting it may be, art it certainly is not, despite its ham-handed pretensions. Questions, questions. I, for one, harbor no hope that they will eventually be answered. For like the castle itself, the castle series is an enigma. Of doubtful provenance, it provokes as much as it entertains. Analyze, explicate, and interpret as is your wont, but do all at your peril, for these books seem to justify the claims of deconstructionist critics who hold that, at bottom, any given text is not susceptible of reduction to any unambiguous meaning. In short, all texts are at once meaningful and meaningless, and there is no final sorting out of their uncertainties for all the critical acumen we bring to bear on them. Like it or not, we must face the fact that there is an intrinsic uncertainty principle even in the humanistic field of belles lettres. All of the above notwithstanding, this is an entertaining book, like its predecessors. Setting aside its stylistic crudities, it reads well. The pace is quick, and we are compelled to turn its pages to see what happens next. We could do worse for our light reading fare. I shall say no more about it. Here, then, is Castle Dreams, puzzling as it is, apocryphal though it may be. In the end, the question of its authenticity could be moot, for Castle Perilous contains not simply a multitude of worlds, but a multitude of possible worlds. Who is to say that the events herein related did not happen in one of them? Certainly not I. Osmeric, Royal Scribe and Librarian. Castle, Gaming Hall. Going to the Toad Fling tomorrow?
I beg your pardon?
Linda Barclay, pretty, blonde, and blue-eyed, sorceress par excellence and general utility magician, looked up from her bridge hand and regarded her partner, Jean Ferraro, with an expression of bemused hauteur. This reaction was something of a pose, a defensive posture now almost automatic, against what she suspected was imminent, more standard Ferraro wisecracking. She said,
"Am I going to the what?"
"Toad Fling," Jean said, carefully aligning his cards as he studied them. "Goodwill Turkey Shoot, World Cup Spitball Meet, whatever they're calling it."
"You mean the All-Worlds Jousting Tournament?" asked Dina Williams, seated to Linda's left.
Turning her dark head slightly, she directed her next remark to the strange creature sitting directly across from her, a large, white-furred beast who happened to be her partner in this rubber. "Your call, Snowclaw." Snowclaw was an understandable moniker in light of the creature's long, icy white claws. Unwieldy as they appeared, they in no way inhibited the casually deft sorting by suit of a hand of bridge. Snowclaw gave a sarcastic grunt.
"Who dealt this mess?"
"You always complain," Jean said. "Every hand, which leads me to believe, you clever beast, that it's some kind of psychological stratagem."
"Some kind of what?"
Snowclaw heaved a sigh.
"Pass.
Don't think you're putting anything over on anyone." "Toad fling," Linda said disapprovingly. "How cruel to toss helpless toads."
"Nonsense," Jean said. "Your regulation flinging toad is bred for the job. They don't mind a bit. In fact, they live to be flung. It fulfills their purpose in life."
"The SPCA should hear about this," Linda said. "I have half a mind to report it myself. 3 spades.
"What's this toad flinging stuff anyway?"
Dina was curious to learn.
"I thought it was knights on horses running at each other with spears."
"Pass."
"Lances," Jean corrected.
"Well, I heard they de-emphasized the traditional combat angle. Now it's mostly track and field. Sort of a medieval Olympics, though they still do hold the joust. And a contestant still stands a chance of getting his neck broken.
4. No trump."
"Or hers," Linda said. "They have a woman's joust, too."
4 no trump, Jean? You sure are adventurous today. Remember, we're vulnerable."
"Too late," Dina said. "No taking back bids."
"Going for the slam?"
Snowclaw speculated.
"Need a little danger, huh?"
Jean let out a breath. "It's been so damned boring around here lately. I crave excitement once in a while."
Snowclaw said,
"I've been getting a little antsy myself now that you mention it." "Pass."
"Speaking of adventurism, maybe you're not playing possum."
"What's a possum?"
Snowclaw looked capable of handling any excitement that might come his way. A cross between a polar bear and a bipedal cat, he had fierce yellow eyes over a snout full of wicked teeth. For all that, his disposition seemed amiable enough. There were other castle guests in the gaming hall. At one chess table, Cleve Dalton and Lord Peter Thaxton had locked horns in an especially desperate endgame. They sat unmoving, eyes on the board. In another corner, Melanie McDaniel, russet-haired and freckle-faced, strummed a guitar, singing some Scots ballad or another. She played well, but her alto voice squeaked in the upper registers. Nevertheless, 5 listeners sat around her in cross-legged appreciation.
"All this, our South, stinks of peace," Jean said.
Dina frowned suspiciously. "Are you quoting poetry again?" She cocked her head toward Linda.
"He's quoting poetry again."
"Right, but I wrote it," Jean said.
"Liar,"
Linda said casually.
"Oh, all right. It was actually penned by one of the immortal bards,
a laureate among poets." When no one obliged, Dina reluctantly asked,
"Oh yeah? Who?"
"Geraldo."
"Get out."
"No, really. It was during his futurist period."
"Your call, Linda."
5 diamonds.
"1 ace is all you have?"
Snowclaw was amused.
"Except for the one up my sleeve, you stinker."
Snowclaw chuckled.
"We'll just let you guys hang yourselves."
"Going for the slam," Dina said. "You're right, Snowy. We gonna watch him twist slowly in the wind. I pass."
"Jean, why don't you go off somewhere?" Linda said,
and get yourself into something. Take Snowy, go exploring. Pick a world, any world. After all, the castle has 144,000 of them. Jean leaned back and scratched his left thigh, tugging at the stretchable material of his green tights. Hell, we've done that. Just last week, we hiked off into that aspect with the ruined temples in a sort of jungle setting. Know the one I mean?
I know of several, Linda said.
The ones that look vaguely like Angkor, through the portal near the stairwell to the King's Tower?
Oh, that one. Anything interesting?
Jean shrugged. Ruins? Jungle? Great for archaeologists. Otherwise, it was pretty boring, and the mosquitoes were as big as hang gliders.
I'm still itching, Snowy said.
After we came out of there, Jean went on. We tried a few more aspects, but they were washouts too. Maybe we've explored all the interesting ones.
I find that hard to believe, Linda said.
Maybe I just need a change.
Why don't you go back home for a little vacation? How are your parents, by the way?
They're in Florida for the winter.
Go there.
Don't care for Florida in the winter, or the summer.
Go to California. You haven't been there since...
Linda realized too late she was treading sensitive ground. Since Via threw me over to a biker mall? Jean said.
Sorry, didn't mean to bring up painful memories.
Oh, it's all right. After all, she was a barbarian queen when I found her. And after all attempts at civilizing, she reverted to type. Castle kidnapped. I just hope she's happy.
Do you think she's still in Southern California?
The club she joined is based in L.A., but she could be anywhere, Jean said as he made a minute adjustment in the arrangement of his cards. And who knows if she stayed with that particular fraternity of motorcycle aficionados? Dina asked,
When did you last hear from her?
I haven't heard from her since that letter telling me she was dropping out of UCLA.
Maybe you should go look for her, Linda said.
Jean scowled. Whatever for? As I said, I hope she's found happiness. As a tribal queen, she was used to being serviced by a cohort of husbands and male concubines. Mayhap a biker gang is just her cup of tea.
You sound just a little bitter, Linda said.
Do I? I'm not. Not at all. The binding continued, Jean calling with 5 no trump, Linda telegraphing her 2 kings by Blackwood convention.
6 hearts.
Pass, Dina said.
Your bid, Jean, honey. And just remember, there's always another fish in the ocean.
I hate fish. Oh, what the bloody hell. 7 no trump. Linda rolled her eyes to the high vaulted ceiling.
Jean, you shouldn't have.
Snowclaw chortled.
A grand slam. You're never going to make it, good buddy.
Live dangerously, I say. What else have I got to occupy my time? Besides, it's a verbal contract, and as everyone knows...
Jean, Linda said, there's no excuse for boredom. You live in Castle Perilous, which just happens to be the most interesting place in the entire universe, in the whole darn omniverse, or whatever you call the big thing that contains all the littler universes.
Multiverse. Jean gave a tiny shrug. Well, as the Bauhaus boys said, less is more, more or less. Snowclaw blinked.
Huh?
I never liked their movies, Linda said.
You should take up golf, Jean, a new voice broke in. The bridge players turned to regard lean, wiry Cleve Dalton, who was sitting back after making a move that had been prefaced by a good 15 minutes of thought. Dalton had the face of a Yankee storekeeper and the manner of a high-end, billable-hour lawyer, though in his pre-Perilous life he'd been a literary agent. Jean said, But you guys gave it up. Dalton pointed to his opponent.
He did, not me.
Dina asked, "You really swore off for good, Lord Peter?"
Lord Peter Thaxton looked up from the chessboard. Dressed in a maroon smoking jacket with ascot, he was light-haired and distinguished-looking. Although he likely hadn't hit 40 yet, his face was the sort that might have looked middle-aged at age 25.
"I'll never swing a mashy niblick again."
"Or a brassy, or a cleek," Dalton added.
"None of those items."
"Lord Peter, you always hated playing," Jean said. "Yet you always let Mr. Dalton goad you into it."
"No more," Lord Peter said. "I shall not be playing golf again, ever."
"He means it," Dalton said gravely, nodding. "Ever since he solved the Peel Castle murders, he's been impossible."
Castle murders.
"Mr. Dalton," Linda said, "you can surely find another golf partner."
"Oh, I play a few holes with Rashid occasionally, but it's just not the same. Half the fun was listening to his lordship swear."
"I'm glad to have provided you with so many hours of amusement," Lord Peter said dryly.
"You did, old boy, you did."
"Though hereafter, you'll have to look elsewhere for fun and games, I'm afraid."
"But I can still hear you cuss when I beat you at chess."
"This one's not over. Don't take a hen house census just yet, old man."
"Merely a matter of time, m'lord."
Lord Peter merely grunted as he studied the board. "Well," Jean said, "something will come along. Something always does. And then I regret that things aren't boring anymore. Meanwhile, I try to avoid boring myself and others."
"You're about as boring as a 10-car pileup," Dina said. "Is that it, Mr. Bridgewiz? Or are we going to have to go around with this nonsense again?"
"Yes, ma'am. Who leads?"
"I'm dummy," Linda said.
"Then I lead," Snowclaw said.
He laid down the six of hearts. "By the way," Jean said, "where's Incarnadine been lately?"
"Who knows?" Linda said. "As usual, he's had business off in one of his many universes.
A finger in every cosmological pie.
For a king, he does get around."
Melanie finished her Scots ballad, smiled at the applause, then launched into a Breton folk song. The hand went badly for Jean and Linda. With Linda's hand as dummy, Jean played a club to her queen and ran the Jack of Diamonds. He played cagily enough after that, testing clubs, running them, then testing hearts by playing his eight to the dummy's queen. He took every trick but the last. The defenders were one card too strong in hearts, Dina spoiling with her jack. The contract was blown.
"Rats," Jean said mildly, throwing in his hand. "You should have been content with the little slam," Snowclaw said.
"Content," Jean mused.
"You seem kinda troubled, chum."
"Weltschmerz."
"What's that?"
Linda said. "Sounds German. Jean, you're always using foreign words to show off."
"Yeah, that's me. Your basic intellectual snob. You ought to hear me swear in Sanskrit." "Is that a town?"
Snowclaw asked. "You're thinking of Scranton," Jean said, "and I've uttered mighty oaths there too." Jean slowly got to his feet. "Well, I think I'll take a walk."
"Want some company?"
Snowclaw asked. "No thanks, big guy. I think I want a solo this time. Gotta do some thinking."
"Suit yourself."
"See you later, people," Jean said in general farewell, waving as he strolled away. Snowclaw watched him leave, then shook his massive head.
"I don't know. I'm kind of worried about him. He's been acting funny lately."
"Cabin fever," Linda said. "You hang around the castle too much, you get it."
Melanie walked over. A steel string was dangling from her guitar.
"Busted my high E," she said. I'll have to go back home to find another.
No need for that, Linda said. She sat back, crossed her arms, and closed her eyes. Something materialized on the card table, a small packet. Melanie reached for it eagerly.
Bless my soul, a new guitar string!
In fact, she was not in the least surprised, having witnessed Linda's materialization talents many times.
Thanks, Linda.
No problem,
Linda said, then yawned. Recovered, she asked,
Where are your kids?
As if on cue, two bonneted nursemaids, each wearing a swaddled infant, entered the hall.
Here they are,
Melanie said, running to meet them. She took one of the babies and carried it back to the table.
Can you tell them apart? Linda asked.
Always could,
Melanie said, holding the infant up.
This one's Rafe. Want to hold him?
Me? Sure.
Hey, I want one of those,
Dina said.
Your own or one of these?
Both, but for now, I'll take this one's brother.
You get Gareth. Here, Linda. Be sure to support his head. Like this, see?
Linda gingerly accepted the precious burden.
Oh, he's a heavy little rascal, isn't he?
Melanie took the other baby and went to Dina.
They're both gaining weight fast.
Dina expertly enfolded Gareth in her arms. Linda tickled Rafe's tiny dimpled chin.
Hey there, kiddo.
Not yet cognizant of humorous gestures, Rafe was dismayed.
Thank you,
Melanie called after the nursemaids as they left the room. To Linda, she said,
They eat like lumberjacks. My boobs are always sore.
You're lucky to have enough milk to breastfeed,
Dina said.
Breastfeeding is best for babies if it's possible, but it's hard to nurse twins. By the way, where has Jean gone off to?
Nowhere in particular,
Linda told her.
He's been looking kind of depressed lately.
It really hasn't shown until recently, but he's been unhappy since Via ditched him,
Linda said.
He won't admit it, but she was the love of his life. She must have been something. A real bombshell.
With eyebrows arched appreciatively, Dalton said,
I'll second that.
Ever since, Linda went on, Jean's been traipsing through one castle aspect after another, trying to find something to take his mind off her. As I said, he'd never admit it, but it's the truth.
When did he lose her?
Melanie wanted to know.
Shortly before you came to the castle, I think it was.
I don't understand you humans,
Snowclaw said.
Linda turned her head. What don't you understand, Snowy?
Mating. I mean, the way humans carry on about it.
How is it handled in your world? I don't think I've ever asked before.
Handled?
How is it, done?
Snowclaw shrugged.
Well, you just do it. It's something that's gotta be done, and you just go out and get it over with. That's all. And then you go back home and sleep for a week.
I see.
Maybe that's preferable,
Dalton commented. No fuss, no hearts and flowers.
Maybe it's the best way, Linda said. But it doesn't sound like very much fun.
Fun?
Snowclaw said dubiously.
What does fun have to do with it?
Linda began, Well, you...
Then she thought better of it.
Snowy, maybe you'd better talk to Jean about this.
Anything you say, Linda. Actually, I'm not all that interested in the subject, if you want to know the truth.
Dalton interjected. Sometimes I think the subject isn't worthy of all the attention that's usually paid it.
Anyway, Linda said, I wish Jean would forget about the past. He's been so glum lately. He hasn't been much fun at all. One thing he knows how to do is liven things up, when he's in the right mood.
He'll get over her, Melanie said,
just like I got over the father of these little joy bundles.
You don't still think of Chad?
Linda asked pointedly.
Melanie gave a wan smile.
Oh, every once in a while. Sometimes at night, when the castle is quiet.
Melanie suddenly frowned.
You know, Linda, for months now I've been telling you all the secrets of my love life, and just now it suddenly struck me that I know zero about yours. Fair is fair.
Linda snorted.
Me? What love life? Oh, come on. I've been ditched so many times I've thought of buying a backhoe. I think you did mention a boyfriend once. Yeah, I had one or two of those, and even a fiancé, but it all came to zilch zip.
I feel as though I'm eavesdropping, Dalton said, eyes on the chessboard.
I got no dirt to hide, no scandal, Linda said. Kind of wish I did.
Melanie struck a pose.
Meanwhile, I must struggle with the stigma of the unwed mother, she said, giving the line a dramatic reading.
Nobody cares about that anymore, Linda said.
I do. I still believe in marriage. Call me old-fashioned.
Like sex, Dalton said, and love for that matter, marriage is beyond the realm of fashion. It's a necessary institution. Always was, always will be.
You're an old fogey, Mr. Dalton, Linda said.
My dear, you are quite right, and I glow with pride of it.
Snowclaw asked,
Just what is marriage, anyway?
There was an awkward silence. Dalton began,
Well, it's...
There was a commotion in the corridor. Shouts, then murmuring voices. I wonder what's up, Linda said.
I'll go see,
Melanie said and hurried to the open door.
Maybe it's the excitement Jean was looking for, Dalton speculated. In Castle Perilous, you don't have to wait very long for some.
I don't like excitement, Dina said nervously. I like it when it's quiet. Linda said,
I get kind of nostalgic for the calmer periods myself, sometimes, especially when the sludge starts hitting the whirling blades.
Yeah, I can do without that sludge stuff, Dina said, scowling. Ever since I come here, it's been flying. First it was the blue meanies invading, then it was demons, then crazy people coming out of mirrors scaring everybody.
Castle for rent and castle war.
Dina shook her head. I don't need that.
It does get interesting around here at times,
Dalton admitted.
But it's good for the circulation, gets the blood racing. It's always good to...
Ha-ha! Dalton regarded his chess opponent, from whom the outburst had come.
What on earth has gotten into you?
Lord Peter sat back, a triumphant smirk on his lips.
I moved.
Well, congratulations. What did you move?
Bishop to Queen's 3. There. You're in check.
Dalton studied the board.
So I am.
You always manage to squirm out of it, but this time I've got you. You're hemmed in on all sides. You must either move your king or take the bishop with the queen. But doing the latter will put your queen in jeopardy. And if you move your king, it's only a matter of time before I corner you.
Lord Peter folded his arms and gloated.
What a jam, Dalton said appreciatively. Quite a nice little trap you set for me.
And have just sprung mercilessly.
So you have. So you have. Unless...
Lord Peter sat up.
Unless...
Well, if I'm not mistaken, if I take your king's bishop with my queen's, you're in check. And, unless I'm entirely misapprehending the strategic situation, that's mate.
Lord Peter saw with horror that Dalton was right.
Impossible!
I would not kid his lordship.
Lord Peter looked ill.
I think I'll go to my room and blow my bloody brains out.
Here, here, that's hardly called for. Besides, you'll have the chambermaids all upset.
Lord Peter thought it over.
You're right. They'll refuse to step into the place and there'll be no end of mess.
He gave the matter more consideration.
I'll throw myself off the King's Tower.
Now you're being reasonable.
The giggling from Dina and Linda quickly faded as Melanie came running into the room. They saw the look on her face.
Melanie, what's wrong?
Linda asked uneasily.
It's the servants,
Melanie said grimly.
They're saying something happened to Lord Incarnadine. Word came through from the aspect he's in. My God, what? They're saying...
Melanie swallowed hard and tried again.
They're saying he's dead.
Keep, near the Queen's Tower, lower levels. Lugging a huge sheaf of fan-folded paper, a computer printout, Jean trudged the hallways of Castle Perilous, looking for a doorway into an interesting universe. His explorations of the past 2 weeks hadn't turned up a portal worth slipping into, and this outing was no exception. He stopped. Before him stood an anomaly, an archway that opened onto a pleasant landscape of trees, grass, shrubs, and bright sunlight. The anomaly consisted in the fact that this innocuous scenery did not lie outside the castle in the normal sense. It was part of another world, one belonging to a universe entirely separate from the one that the castle occupied. In the castle nomenclature, this doorway to a strange cosmos was an aspect. He consulted the printout. It was a list of aspects with names and descriptions, grouped according to location in the castle. Jean thumbed through the pages covering the 14th floor of the keep. There were hundreds of listings, and the locations were somewhat vague. For instance, 12 paces east, along common bearing wall between Tinker's Stall and Queen's Lady's Sewing Room, to right of foliated pilaster. Big help. There were hundreds of empty rooms on this floor. No one knew which had been what a millennium or two ago, when this catalog of aspects had been compiled. The data had come from an ancient book in the castle library and had recently been sorted by the castle's mainframe computer. But Jean thought he had this aspect pegged. Arcadia, he read aloud from the printout. Clement, peaceful. Salubrious climate. Fauna, small and inoffensive. Population, by all indications, uninhabited. Flora, extensive, variegated, otherwise undistinguished. Another park-like aspect, of which the castle had thousands. Pleasant, good for picnics and outings. Hills, trees, and grass. Of little interest to a man hungering for high adventure. Jean moved on. He had
changed from. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.